So there are like there's not major changes as such, but there are some cool things around. We'll talk about it. Like on noticing few changes, I looked at few things which is new. So I have some samples on it, and this is the first time I think I have a slide too. So there's a lot of changes around tool chains, runtimes, libs, and the core library. There's always changes in GCs to optimize all those things. But I haven't taken down everything. You guys should go look into the release notes that have the entire information. So first thing is, how many of you have wet part of your code on like pipeline in things? Oh, okay. Wet is actually a analysis tool. It actually reports some errors. There's also linters which actually suggest things, but wet is, you know, you're not adhering to idiomatic code. So ideally, you should have that as part of your pipeline because you're breaking idiomatic code because that's what everybody follow. Some example could be like in a when you are initializing a struct, when you don't have a values with keys, and then like when you have some values with keys, like whenever there's consistency, this guy reports. So till now we had to do it explicitly, but with Go 1.10, whenever you run tests, they run Go wet also. So one context, my Go version is 1.10, okay. And whenever I want to run something on Go 1.9, I'll run with this, okay. Just the default version. My default version is Go 1.10. So I have this sample code where, you know, if I do this go wet dot, I have some errors. Like example, printf has percentages, but you are passing integer, which is an issue. So earlier go 1.9 test, if I do this, I don't have any errors. Like in fact, I can show you the code. I mean, I don't have any code there. It just has some dummy test file. So yeah. So I just have a dummy test file, but when I run with Go 1.10, by default it is considered as an error. So which is actually nice because they think that, you know, you have to write idiomatic Go, and then like if you run tests, it'll fail. So which means it's sort of mandated, which is actually cool. So this is around the wet, but still, if you want to skip it, you can actually use wet off. This you can check it. And the other thing is, they started caching the test results. Like I don't know, there are some libraries which does it. Like they cache the test results, and then like you don't need to run it again. Go 1.10 started doing it. The best part is, you know, when you have a DB test or when you have something, mostly we tend to work on a single package, and the changes, though you do it in a single package, it takes a long time because it runs all the tests in all the other packages. So Go 1.10, it caches everything. By default, it shows the elapsed time for each and every package when you run tests. But now, if you are using this, if it is using a cached result set, it shows cached. So we can just have a look at something. So let's say Go 1.9 test. So this takes a long time. Hope it's running. Sorry, my bad. I started running some things. Okay. I mean, I don't have Redis server running at all, but probably I'll start the server just for the sake. Yeah. Okay. Now I'm running test in 1.10. So it'll take time, but it'll show the elapsed time. And then we can see, as running tests. So if you noticed here, it shows the timestamps which is elapsed. Okay. Now if I run the test again, it is actually instant, and it says it is actually using the cached result of this. So this is also a nice feature. And this helps at least in dev perspective because it reduces the feedback time. And even if you want to skip it, you can actually do go count is equal to 1 and do the test, and it'll skip caching it. So that's one. And one more thing is, this is pretty much everything in test, which is actually really nice. They improved a lot. Let's say you have a lot of tests, and when there's a lot of tests failing, it dumps all the information, which is actually weird. Then you have to go look at each and every failure and then fix it. But rather, this fail fast, as it stands for, whenever the first test fails, it stops the execution. So that is what Go 1.10 has. So I'll try to see whether I have, I think I'll have failing test here. Let's just see. Yeah, there's like multiple failing tests, but go test fail first. There's like test the list. Embedded custom response writer. I think it's in the same file, but I didn't create one separately for this. But it should work as expected. Probably we can test it later. So this is that. So after any test failure, it won't run any further tests. One more thing is, I don't know what Fossil is, but till now, we use the default Go package, but Fossil seems like they have added that repository to the GoGet. I haven't used much, but it's a point, good thing. Other thing is, earlier, if you remember, the context was in this package, which is part of XNIT. It was an external package, still part of it. And a lot of people, I think, still have it. And as you know, like all our prod systems, it's not easy to change. So what they've introduced is a Go tool fix dot, and they'll convert all the old context imports to the newer context. Context. So I have something, Go SQL, yeah. So ignore this, I have old imported context here. So I'm just gonna do go tool fix here, and then it fix changes. So it actually converted all the packages, all the files from the net context to the default, like our current context package.
Does it work for all the packages, not only context? Yes.
It actually changed everywhere. Like you just have to do for, dot slash dot dot dot, right?
I'm talking about like, is it specifically for context or?
No, it's specifically for context, just for context.
Okay.
Because they migrated the context from external package to the internal context, right? Yeah. So it's just for context, nothing else. So this is that.
The migration happened in
long back, but obviously we wouldn't change our code because we stick to the older libraries because it's not easy to change, right? It's because of that. And a few more changes. Pprof, I don't know how many people used it. It's actually for tracing, and it emits Go routines, heap memory, dump, CPU profiling, all those things. You can enable pprof, and then you can debug Go routine leaks or memory leaks. It was very helpful whenever we had leaks. It has a nice information. But when you were about to look at the pprof, like you basically will get a pprof dump. You run your program, take a dump, and finally when you want to see it, how you will run it is, I think I'll have some command. It'll be something like go tool pprof, and then you have to give the binary and also the dump file. The reason was, the way pprof was generated was, it was purely metrics, but the symbols where something is happening, it was all still inferred from the binary which was generated. So you had to pass it, so this guy had was creating links between these two. So now in this Go, I'll just finish this. So in this Go 1.10, you don't need to pass the binary. It also generates the symbols along with the pprof dump. So you don't need to pass it. Yes.
I think this was in 1.9.
The pprof itself?
Yeah, I think.
Okay.
Because I used to do it without all the...
No. Yes, you can still do it, but you lose some information.
Okay.
So if you do top 10 and then if you want to see where it happens, you had to pass it. So that was optional. But here you don't need to pass it at all. All the information is internally inside the pprof dump itself. So yeah, that was one thing. And so even I was using it differently. Like we have Go tools, which is Golang, Wet, and we saw Fix right now. Even I've used it in multiple ways. You know, you can do Go Wet, and you can also do Go Tool Wet. I don't know what is the difference. We should still explore. But the GoVet seems to have all the conditions, rules, everything. And they are discouraging from you to use GoToolVet. So you shouldn't use GoToolVet anymore, but rather use GoVet. So yeah, you can probably read up on it. And how many of you have set GoRoot? Okay, so like for the beginners, it was always a confusion, what is GoPath and GoRoot. So GoPath is always your working directory. Like that's where all your Go source code lies. But rather GoRoot is something where your Go package is installed, like Golang is installed. Earlier you had to set it, and if you mess up with it, you won't get the proper environment running. So in Go 1.10, from Go 1.10, you don't need to set it. By default, it infers, wherever it is installed, it infers the location. So you don't need to set it. You just need to set one variable, which is GoPath. I mean, it seems like a simple thing, but for ideally, you have to set two variables. Now it's just one, which is cool. So when you try to use pprop, which I was talking about earlier, the documentation wasn't that good enough. You had to explore by your own. And even debugging, how many of you guys use debugging tools? GDB, something, Dell? Okay, cool. Like that is a major two things, but mainly we relied on print statements, right? So the documentation wasn't good enough, but now they have a proper documentation for all these things, which is profiling, tracing, and debugging. So profiling, now you can see what I was talking about, like it has CPU, heap, threads, coroutines, and all those stuff. This is a nice thing, you guys should look at it. Even if you haven't tried it, ideally if you're running a prod system, I would suggest you to use pprop and then see whether you have any leaks or not. Because when you hit a scale or something, it'll be very obvious. Number of goroutines and their memory leak will be obvious. But if it doesn't have a huge scale, you might not see it explicitly. So you should probably explore this and then do a load test and then see the profiling results. So this is a nice documentation which talks about tracing, debugging, profiling, and GoDebug. So GoDebug, I don't know whether you guys use. There also, you can set multiple, just like Go Max Prox, right? You can set this GoDebug environmental variable, and depending on that, it will dump more verbose information. So example, I was trying out gRPC. I didn't know what the proper error was. But if I after setting this, it dumps more information, so it's easy to debug. So this is also, it's just a documentation change. Okay. Okay, GoFumpt. So there is one change in GoFumpt. Like if it is a one method interface, yeah, ideally, like for our newbies, people or everybody suggests having a single method in interface. It's actually good. Like you don't need to club all the methods. And if you have so, it used to GoFumpt in a way that, like, you know, the interface will be in first line, the method will be in next line, and the brace in the last. At least I disliked it. But the Go 1.10 GoFumpt allows you to have it in a single line. So, I'll just show what I had. So, please. So this is the thing. So, like my Vim is attached to still with older version. So if I try to do this and then save it, it automatically converts into multi-line. I didn't like it, but Go 1.10, it actually converts into it's okay to have it converts into a single line. It is acceptable. So source Go 1.10, Go font dot. Okay, I'll just run this file. Go font release.go. I have to change it in a different thing. So let me just change it in a different editor. Yeah. So Yeah. So this is okay. Which Go font. So this GoFumpt is actually 1.10, it's pointing to 1.10, and it is acceptable. So GoFumpt 1.9 release, yeah, you got the diff right. So it's just a pure styling, nothing else, but it's still nice. So this is to do with this. The other thing is, again, one more Go form thing. But how many of you have used or heard about three-index slicing? Okay, cool. That I have a code. Probably it's good to discuss. Even after looking at this, I explored this. I'll show you what it does. Then later we'll dive into what it means. Okay, I think I have it on a slices. So cap slice. Okay. Yes. Visible? Okay. So earlier Go 1.9, like this is the capacity and this is the length, and earlier the format is, you know, colon spaced with capacity colon length together, but slices less go formed capped sliced or go. So this guy actually converts into you know, two separated spaces. Like, I don't know how much it's valuable, you might think it, but now I actually wanted to show and talk about what is this three-index slicing. So you define a slice and you have a slice, but when you want to slice it down, you say where it starts and then like till where you have to end it, right? You actually cut down, like just like a Python, same thing. I'll just show the take some more show an example and then we'll show. Okay, so here we go. Okay, so we have a slice which is of 5 digits, and like we are passing it to weird slice. We'll see what it does, and then we are saying slice till 3, like, you know, just till 3. And when you actually compare the input, so we are actually passing the input to the some process, and you have to compare it back to the slice, which is actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So ideally it should work fine, right? So let's go into the weird slice. Okay, so it's just like, you can't say, you know, if you have 5 elements, you can't give 0 to 10, that'll error out. So that's why I have this condition, ignore this. So what I'm doing here is, you can also ignore this. This is just for a formed showcase. But I'm saying pick up elements from 0 till 3. That's it. And I'm appending an element, but we'll come to this later. So, I'll just take out all slices in these parts. Okay, so we have a slice, we are passing a slice and also an integer. We are slicing it from 0 till that integer that you passed. And we are taking that slice and then adding an element to it. And then you're returning that result, okay? So ideally, we don't expect the backed array. Like I'm jumping into the solution right away. We don't expect the thing which you passed to change. And you expect a new subset with 500 attached to it, nothing else. So this is a new slice, you know, 1, 2, 3, the default cut elements from the back array, and then you expect a 500, which is what we appended. Like, is everybody in the same page? Like, if you have questions, you can ask. Like, so then I'm gonna do go test dot, and just a second. I think I'm in a different. I'll just run this test. Go test weird behavior. Well, I just wanted to fail. Let me just see. Okay. Cool. Yes. Okay. So I changed the slice array. Sorry. It changed the other element. Give me a minute. I'll just ignore this test. I'll run this again. Okay, I don't know why it's not sorry, yeah, I forgot. I totally forgot. I added one change, which is actually breaking this. So sorry, yes. To summarize, we had a slice, we took three elements and we appended 500 to it. So we expect 1, 2, 3, 500 as a new subset. And the original array, we wanted it still to be same. So now if we see what is happening, you expect 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but it is actually 1, 2, 3, 500, 5. Like this is a good, this is a thing which changed, but if you didn't get it, please ask me questions. So like even last time we discussed slices, there is actually backed array. And if you actually see here, this is the first array. It has a length of 3, like the first one. And this address is 3C0. And the other one is also 3C0. So everything uses the same memory. It's actually backed array and then it uses the same memory. You can have multiple slices, just a pointers. Imagine just a window. And then you can have a lot of slices. Everything point to the same backed array. But the problem was you created a subset and then you returned that. But though you appended an element to it, it added a value to the backed array. So which means it changed the original array. Like, does it make sense? Like, if you say no, like, probably I'll try to explain. That's why I'm asking. So we had something like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which is a slice. So let's say this starts at 2x000 address. We had another slice, which is not a real copy, but rather it is another slice saying length is 3 and starting address is 2x00. So which means this, when you refer it, it will have 1, 2, 3 value. So when you try to append 500 to it, it goes and changes back the original array. So this is what happened. So now, like, there is also one more concept, right? When do you generate a new slice, right? So when you have a slice of this, you might have all used, let's say this is backed array, right? Let's say this is backed array. And then you keep appending some x to it. When does this change or when does this grow or will the address always remain same? Like, anybody want to take a call? Yes, exactly. So yes. So what he said was, like, you know, when the capacity over, which means you have a sequential memory, but it doesn't mean that you have the whole memory in hand. So you might have array one in the first set and then array two in next to you. But when you have 5 elements, when you want to add another element, you can't add it. So what it does is it copies into a different place and it assigns more values. To give more example, you can actually run it and see. Like, I have an example, but I don't want to go right there now. Ideally, it increases, you know, with a multiplier of 2 to the power of n. That's how it increases. So initially, it will have two elements. And then when you add the third element, it will become 4. And then it will become 8, 16, and 32. The reason itself is, you know, when you have smaller elements, it's okay to copy. But when you have an element of 1024, and when you keep adding element one by one, you don't want to make a copy every time. So they double the size of the array so that all the other 1024 elements doesn't need a copy. So abstractly, this is the concept, right? So given both of these theories, so now what they have introduced, right? Like that you also say what is the length. So here you say slice length. So here basically you are saying let's just keep this. So now the new element length, right? It could be anything last time, but here we are saying the capacity and length both to be 3. So what it means is the moment you add another element, it have to copy it into a different place because your capacity, you don't have any more capacity to add even one more element. So what we are doing is you take n elements out of it. And you say even the, I keep confusing whether it is a capacity or length. I think it's capacity and length. But in this case, both capacity and length is same. So which means if you add one more element to it, it will have to give a new copy. So now if we go back to the test and then run it, it will pass. Like, and you can see here, initially, like I'll show you what I'm printing and then we can talk about it. So here we are inspecting the subset, you know, this is the new result, okay? And this is the original. And this is the new, which is after append, okay? Appended new something. I must. Fine. So I'm just printing, appending elements, printing the subset slice, and then original, and then the new set after append. So, sorry. Sorry, it's a method which is there. I can't print more. Like I can add print element prints here. Original. New after append. Okay. So now the new thing is having capacity of 3 and 3. The start address is 4180. And the backed array, the original array, right, that also have the same address. And that length is 5. Like that capacity and length is 5. So now the moment I said 3, right, it added an element and which resulted in this moving to a separate address and whole new location. So because of which it's passing. So I think we can go back to the same error state and then this will be obvious again. So here, if you noticed, it was 5 and the length was 3, because of which you were able, yes, now it makes sense. The capacity is higher. The moment you exceed the capacity, then you can't add elements. So if I want to add an element, it actually added the element in the backing original array. Yes, so this makes sense, right? So this is what this formatting is. This is what this formatting is. So it means you're actually taking a slice from I plus 1, and then you are taking mentioning capacity and length. That's it. And that they change the format to this. So the GoFormed way of defining this changed. So this is that change. It's to do with GoFormeds. And yeah, I had the same code here. Same thing, nothing else. So debugger, I haven't used it much, but they mentioned they added more information for debuggers to make use of it. So it's easy to step down and then see the line information, all those kind of things. So who are using GDB and Dell will know better. And runtime, they added automation and they, like there's no clear benchmarks, but it should take less CPU utilization and then like GC should have lesser pastimes and, you know, performance overhead should be reduced slightly. That's a statement, but we don't have a clear benchmark on that. And there is a lot of changes in core library. This is where you should go and look at it. Archive, Buff.io, Bytes, Crypto, all those packages, like a lot of packages, it's changed. But I just have some example which we use daily so that we know what is the difference. So they added a size method on both readers and writers. So which means I have a writer, I have a reader. Now I can see what is the backing buffer size behind it. So I here the writer is 4096 and the readers is 9. The readers is 9 because it has 9 elements and you're reading it. It's just a way of exposing it. I don't know whether it's like we would use it every day, but this is useful in a sense if you miss some length or the new element, the buffer mismatch the size, you won't get the data. So it might be helpful in that case. So they are exposing what is the buffer size underneath. So this is that. This is a new addition. So whatever we talked before, right? Like the three indexes. Earlier example split, right? Split, you take a string and then it takes a delimiter and it returns multiple slices. It was returning just the without the default capacity as length. So now all this fields, fields func, split, split after, they return the subslices, which is same as the capacity, the length and capacity, which is the same. So whatever we discussed right now, right? All these four functions makes like they introduce changes here. So because of which they don't want, like you won't cause any effect in the original slice. So you can go have a look at this. Like I don't know. Like I don't want to run into the information. You can just show, go and see it. There's a lot of changes in encoding as well. But one cool thing was, you know, all this hex CSV, you can, if you are using it, go ahead and please look at it. JSON, pretty much all of us use it. Here they added on the decoder, there is a function, which is disallow unknown fields. So what it does is, by default, you have a struct, and then it has, let's say, three fields. You can always pass four fields, five fields, 10 fields, and it decodes only the elements which you have in the struct. So now if you define this thing, it will fail. I'll just show this thing. So there is a gopher and you have an ID and name. This is the struct you're expecting. And earlier you do this, you can pretty much pass more information, let's say x to 1. And I have this running in main. I'll just comment, uncomment this. So yeah, so I have a struct with ID and name, and I have a data which has more information, ID, name, and also X. And you try to decode it, it will not panic. So let's just see this. So yeah, it has ID and name decoded. But now when I actually say, disallow unknown fields, which means this will panic because I don't know what X is. So like the way I look at this being helpful is we always have one contract in services, and still people end up sending more information because it's sort of used. If we enforce this, your servers and contracts will always be pruned and it'll be in the same state. So and there's always issues when you have a lot of information and you have no clue where that field is used. It's not easy to remove. So this is useful in that sense. So if the field is unknown, this will basically error out. So this was one interesting thing. So net HTTP, like I haven't used proxies personally, but till now it wasn't possible to have a HTTP 2 as a proxy. So yeah, as you know, proxy is like, you know, you send a request to somebody, but it is proxied through the another service. So now you can define that proxy in the client with HTTP 2. So it's in security terms perspective. Like who are using HTTP 2 and if they have a proxy to do something common, this is really important to them. Because ideally on HTTP connect, two connections, you don't want to do a HTTP proxy and send it, right? So this is another major thing. But this is just a subset. But ideally, you should all go look at this Go 1.10 release notes. And whatever I have, like it has more information than that. And you might be interested in just looking at the last section, which is actually all the code changes, core library changes. Yes, there was also a string builder where, you know, earlier you used to concatenate and there was a buffer thing. Now they have a builder, like just like a Java builder. So you can add multiple strings and get a string, which is more performant. Yeah, if you're using string concatenation, like building up a long string, then you should go look at the string builders also. That's all I had majorly. Please go look at Go release notes and upgrade to recent version. Thank you. If you have any questions, shoot. Yes. I mean, you generally will return a IO copy. You can do a copy and then always return the slice. Like, you don't do slice saying array 0 to 10, but rather you can copy there and return it, which is always safer. Yeah, but this most people use it. It's just that, like, we won't know it. When we hit the issue, then it's a big deal. Like, this is all, I mean, it's a very cornered thing, right? I didn't know about it, but it was pretty cool. Like, if we had issues, then it would have been a, you know, hard time. figuring it out. Yeah. Any other questions? And please talk to me, like, if there is any questions with deployment, CI, test. Like, we are a bunch of folks from Gojek. Anything, any questions, you feel free to ask us. We have most of our services in Golang, and we deal with huge scale. So, yeah, thank you.